is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. Today I have a very exciting episode for you. I'm here in Seven Springs, Pennsylvania at the Seven Springs Mountain Resort to bring you the Mother Earth News Fairs. It's their annual fair that they put on to educate people about and show people products for the same types of things that are in their magazine. Just like growing food, being sustainable, saving the earth, all this kind of stuff. So I'm really excited to be here. Let's head up to the fair. So we're here at Seven Springs, Pennsylvania. This is a great resort. I mean, they must have like snow skiing in the winter. They got a little dry bob letting you go down, ride your dirt bike down the mountain, take the chairlift up. But we're here for the Mother Earth Fair. So I'm really excited to be here. So we're gonna go inside the fair. We're gonna show you around. Maybe I'm gonna go to a talk and we're gonna show you all the exhibits, some of the cool ones anyways. And you'll get to see more just like you're here with me, hanging out with me. So come inside and let's check it out. So now we're standing outside the gardening lecture hall and you can see all the different talks happening. We're gonna make the 1 o'clock talk, how agribiz is making our food less nutritious. So while I believe this is true that agribiz is making our food less nutritious, are they doing it like on purpose or just by accident because they're not focusing on what's really important besides just for them, what's really important is making a lot of profits and from making food that weighs a lot so they could sell it because food that weighs more costs more. So anyways, we're gonna go into lecture hall, we'll show you what it looks like in there. And then at the end, I'll actually come back and give my review or my summary of what I've learned. So here's the lecture hall, and these are some of the nicer lecture halls. They also have outside talks underneath tents. That's kind of nice. This is in like a little classroom type setting. So they're setting up for the talk, and we'll be back in a little bit. So we just got out of the talk, how agribiz is making our food less nutritious. I personally didn't think the talk was really that well put together. It did talk about how food's getting less nutritious, and they gave the specific example of first corn, and then wheat, on how the nutrient levels in the corn and wheat have been going down, and actually they gave a statistic that the protein in the wheat is 50% less than what it used to be. So they encouraged growing heirloom grains and consuming heirloom grains and heirloom crops that were grown long ago because the plants and foods of today have been grown specifically for one thing and have been selected for one thing, which is yield, which you can't blame agribusiness for doing so because they are in business. So she also talked about the differentiation between agriculture and agribusiness, especially when you're trying to grow for profit, because once again, they are all growing for yields and not necessarily nutrient density. The speaker then got into talking about the fruits and vegetables and also cited that, hybridization made nutrient levels go down, but she didn't really have any solid evidence to back this up. So one of my questions at the end of the lecture was asking specifically about this, and the only thing she pointed to was a USDA study where they basically looked at the USDA database from the 1950s to present time to show that the nutrients levels have gone down. But my question was that specifically due to the seeds, the new varieties of seeds being grown, or was it because of the soil and not being so nutritious and like we're depleting the soil all these years and not putting and rebuilding our soils? And I personally thought she didn't really have a good, solid, concrete answer, although she did acknowledge that, varieties may play a factor and also soil nutrient depletion may play a factor, and there also may be other factors including the way the testing is done and likewise. Nonetheless, the message she had from the talk was definitely good, which was to eat a more nutrient-dense foods. And I want to remind my viewers that the most nutrient-dense foods on the planet are the leafy greens. So eat your leafy greens. That's why my program is called Growing Your Greens. And the other thing she talked about is eating less processed foods. So she would agree, like I would agree, that processed foods need to be out of your diet, all the white flours, the white sugars, especially, and I would believe corn and grain-based diets, not optimal. So eat your leafy greens. And that's pretty much what I learned from this talk.
So we're outside here at Seven Springs, and this is the Mother Earth Fair. This is the whole, vendors and speaker area. There's so many different areas for speaking. Here's two of the tents where some speakers are. But there's also so many booths out here now. In this episode, what we're going to do is we're going to go around to some of these booths, and I'm going to share with you some of the cool booths. Now, most of the booths are outside, and there are also a few inside, so I may have a couple inside shots with a cool booth inside as well. So let's head over and check out the booths.
So now we're in the exhibitor area. We're gonna go up to a really cool booth, probably one of my favorite booths. It's a Southern Exposure Seed Exchange, and the reason why I like it so much
is because they have a tomato, pepper, watermelon, and heirloom apple tastings today. So you could sample some free food. So you could learn and also have actually a display of some of the heirloom produce they grow and actually their whole selection of seeds for sale. So over here, they're just sampling some different kinds of apples. Here's one Pitt Maston pineapple apple. So yes, these are apples. They look kind of funny, not like the ones you'd get in the store. Grimes Golden, King David, and Magnum Bonum apples. So they have little samples here. You could take them out. Pre-toothpick for you. Just grab it and eat it. Man, you know what? You just can't get this kind of flavor in apples you buy at your local grocery store. I mean, if you don't have an apple tree, plant an heirloom one. And if you don't have the space for that, definitely buy some apples at your local farmer's market. Support your local farmer that's growing the heirloom and special varieties. One of the things about some of these special varieties like this guy, I mean, this pineapple apple, I mean, most American consumers, unfortunately, probably would not buy this apple because it's really small, doesn't look too good, but let me tell you something. I'm going to go ahead and grab one of these and taste it. Man, has an incredible flavor. It's like sweet, just a little bit tart. Oh, it's so delicious. I love it. They also have some watermelons here for tasting. The Crimson Sweet and the White Wonder. So many people, you know, haven't ever seen a white watermelon. And that's a white watermelon right there. Definitely a good melon. There's the samples there. Try one of those. I love to eat fruits, especially heirloom ones and uncommon ones. They got a few more watermelons around the side, so let's check those out. So this is a white wonder. This is how big it grows, about this large. And you can see it just looks like a pretty much regular watermelon from the outside, but inside, you know, it's white. Here's a really cool one on the outside, but you haven't seen a watermelon like this before unless you grew the yellow moon and stars. And instead of being a standard speckled, you can see it has all the little spots on it, and these are supposed to be moons and stars. So next we're going to go ahead and show you some of the tastings they're doing of the tomatoes and the peppers. They got the Reisentraub heirloom tomato. These are nice 1 ounce fruits, so that's nice cherry size. Next, the sweet bullnose pepper, and they have samples of what the actual peppers look like. They look like a nice pepper. So we're going to go ahead and try that. And the thing about tastings, I wish more seed companies would actually have tastings like this so that you could know what the food's gonna taste like before you buy the seeds. I mean, always the seed descriptions and the seed catalogs make the seeds sound like they're really good, which they may or may not be. But this is really cool to have this tasting and then be able to just walk a few steps over and buy the same exact seeds to grow this exact fruit from Southern Exposure Seed Exchange. Next, here's the sweet chocolate pepper. It's a nice dark chocolate color. It says, large chocolate red sweet pepper that are very sweet. So let me check that out. I don't know that I've ever tasted one of these before. Personally, just looking at this, I'd probably like try to let them ripen up on the plant a little bit more. I've grown sweeter ones. Next, I got the tomatoes, Amish paste tomatoes, largest paste tomatoes, a Vincent Watts heirloom tomato. Here's the purple bell. And once again, in my opinion, this purple bell, while it is purple, probably needs to be a little bit more ripe. Doesn't look like it's completely ripe, and you could tell when they cut that open. You can see it's still green on the inside, and I'm gonna taste that for you guys, let you know if it is ripe or not. Definitely has a green pepper flavor, so not quite as ripe as it should. I think I'm growing those this year in my garden, so I'll show you what color they turn when they're fully ripe.
Do we still have the seed for that?
Next, we got the New Mex mild pepper. This is what they look like. Nice long peppers. San Marzano heirloom tomatoes. I definitely grew those, I think, last year. Sweet banana peppers. So I like that all their sweet bananas are a nice red color. Some people may pick them when they're not quite red. They're quite ripe. You can try it. Definitely good. So the last one is a purple tomatillo. And these are not tomatoes. They come in a little paper husk. And this one looks like a nice, dark, rich, ripe one. And these have a unique flavor. And I encourage everybody to grow these guys. They do need a little bit of heat to ripen up. But definitely good. Over in this area here, you can see they have a nice display of all these different tomatoes and peppers. So from the tomato verde tomatillo to the Aji Dulce pepper. This one's kind of cool. Arkansas Traveler heirloom tomato, yellow pear, Wickline cherry heirloom. I've never actually seen that kind before. Yellow bell. So yes, even though it's called the yellow bell, they ripen up, to different colors. I mean, this isn't quite ripe, and maybe this is getting more ripe. Cherokee purple, ruffled Hungarian. Corno di Toro, sweet peppers. Corona sweet peppers. Jimmy Nardello sweet pepper, I'm growing this one this year. Jalapeno hot peppers, and check it out, you've probably seen jalapeno hot peppers like this in your grocery store sometimes for sale. Most of the time people think, oh yeah, jalapenos, they're supposed to be green. Well, check it out, they've harvested some of them when they're ripe. And when they're ripe, they're red. And I've noticed if I let my jalapenos like really hang out on my plant for longer, actually they're like not quite as hot and spicy. So that's really interesting. Of course, the habanero pepper, one of the hottest peppers. Hot paper lantern pepper. Haven't seen these before. They look like a nice pepper. Czech black hot pepper. Of course, your standard cayenne peppers. Here's a Orzeco hot peppers. And here's a Chinese five color. This one's probably grown normally as an ornamental pepper, but once again, you can't eat these guys. And nice and all different colors in there. And probably the difference in the colors are because the ripeness may vary. And last, the cherry bomb hot pepper. Wow, these cherry bombs actually look a lot different shape than a cherry bomb that I'm used to. That mine are usually a bit smaller and not quite as like UFO-like. So now we're gonna look at some of the seeds they have here at the Southern Exposure Seed Exchange. I mean, you can't buy them here because you're not here, but I am. The fair special, $2 a packet or 3 for $5. Definitely a inexpensive price for some excellent quality seeds. And they have so many different varieties. And once again, you know, something that I've learned at this festival and many of the other fairs and festivals that I've been to is you want to start growing different varieties, preserve all the different varieties that are out there. I mean, if you go to the supermarket, you could buy lettuce or romaine lettuce, but there's many different varieties of romaine lettuce. You mean, you go to the supermarket and buy garlic, but as we're going to see in a second, I mean, there's so many different types of and varieties of garlic that all taste totally unique and different. And when you go to the store, you don't know what variety you're buying. So you get many different flavor, taste sensations, but also nutrient profiles in the different foods that you can grow versus the ones you can buy because, you know, you don't get that selection. So you can see here all different kinds of seeds. I mean, just radishes. There's a whole bunch of just at least a half dozen radishes that you could select from. So I'd encourage you to go to the Southern Exposure Seed Exchange website. That's southernexposure.com. You can request their catalog. This is the 2011 catalog. I'm sure fairly soon they're going to have the 2012 catalog available. And you can just order that free online, or you could save paper, better yet, go to their website, order your seeds online. So all around the Mother Earth Fair, they have all these little signs like, do you know, record number of corn cobs. The world record for most corn cobs on a single plant is 16. Tyler Craig grew the plant in his home in Swedesburg, Iowa, Guinness World Records. So yes, most corn stalks, actually 16 is actually a lot. Maybe most produce under 5 ears of corn or cobs per plant. So it doesn't necessarily yield a lot per plant, so you gotta grow a lot of plants to yield a lot of corn. Right now we're at the Enon Valley Garlic booth, and they're selling all different varieties of garlic that you can grow at home. This year they grew 28 varieties of garlic, and they're selling 21 different varieties, and there's probably a lot more varieties than even that. So you can see here they got French garlic, Korean garlic, Spanish garlic, Romanian garlic, Polish garlic, German garlic, Northern white garlic, so many different kinds. And I think it's so sad that if you go to the grocery store, you just buy garlic and you don't know what variety it is. And you could get a garlic like the Silver Rose. If you want like a nice mild garlic because you're not Italian, you get a Silver Rose garlic, and this garlic's not quite as hot and spicy. But if you like hot and spicy garlic, you might want to go over here.
The soft stem does not get escape the hard neck.
And you want to get the Korean red. This might be one of the hottest garlics that you could get, the Korean red garlic.
Thank you.
And there's all different kinds of garlics in between, and each garlic has a unique flavor amongst itself. So experiment and grow some different varieties of garlic so that you can experience all the different taste sensations and find the best ones that are going to grow not only in your climate zone, because it may grow differently in your climate depending on the variety, but also taste good to you, because that what it is really most important. So there are like 14 different stages here, and I can't make it to all of them. This one has to do, this is the grit stage, and actually they're talking about using pigs for plowing. So I'm not into pigs and plowing. And over in this one, they have a small scale farming stage, and they're talking about the women's role in agriculture from consumer to farmer. So there's, I mean, so many different options and so many different things to hear here. I gotta really be selective about what talks I'm going to, but also I need to make sure I hit all the booth to show some of that to you guys. So hey, let's do that next. Time for another Mother Earth news. Did you know the oldest seed germinated? The world's record for the oldest seed to germinate is a 2,000 year old date seed planted by Dr. Sarah Salon and Dr. Elaine Soloway in Israel in 2005. Guinness World Record. So that brings me to a very important point and a question that I get oftentimes on my show. Hey John, can I use my expired seeds from last year? Well, hey, if they're able to sprout a 2,000 year old date seed, you can try to germinate the seeds in your seed packet from last year. And they won't germinate, but guess what? Maybe they will. And now we're going to check out another booth. This booth is the NOVIC, or Northern Organic Vegetable Improvement Collaborative. So this is a nonprofit that's funded by the USDA to help improve varieties, do plant testing, and also teach the farmers. So they have a nice educational setup over here. And the other thing is that they actually have some free seeds. So first, let's talk about some free seeds. I'm going to grab some free seeds. And then we're going to check out some of the equipment they have to separate seeds and sort seeds and get the chaff off and the dust and all that kind of stuff off. So over here is just some of the varieties that they, samples of some of the varieties of things that they do help breed with their breeding. So this one's really cool. This is a Sweet Reba acorn squash. And this acorn squash is unique because it grows more like a bush than on a vine. So it's going to take up less space and not vine out for like a whole acre. Here's another tomato, and this is a yellow stuffer tomato. So if you look at the picture, that might look like a pepper to you, but this is really a tomato that you could stuff stuff in. And here's a good old scarlet Nance carrot. And let's see, Disiso broccoli and Cascadia snap pea. And I was by here earlier and got some seeds, and the other one I got that they don't have anymore are the Cosmic Purple Carrot. The Juan Flammy Tomato. And the really cool one I got was this one. This is the Honey Nut Butter Squash. So these butternut squashes are 4 to 5 inches long. So these are small mini butternuts. So it's going to produce a lot more on the vine than just like one large butternut or a few large butternuts on the vine. So this is the place that really comes out with the new varieties. Really cool. Next, let's take a look at some of the equipment they use to sort their seeds. So if you want to get me a good Christmas gift, this is what you guys need to get me. Get me one of these seed machines that you put in all the stuff. So here's some like cabbage seeds, and you put it in the machine, you hit this, turn this little thing on, and it cleans your seeds out. So you can see it kind of moving back and forth, a little bit loud. It just shakes all the crud off your seeds. And in the bottom here, it'll give you a little tray full of all your seeds. Now, we was empty, so we didn't have any seeds. But if you can't afford one of these machines, and this is an old-fashioned machine, but even these new machines, probably like at least $1,000, you could just get your standard screen. So they have basically a screen here, and they have different size screens that you could actually put in here, different size holes. And you put your, in this case, cabbage, and put it in this box, and you just shake it up. And this is kind of what I do with like bowls and seeds and stuff, and then in the bottom you're going to get mostly the seeds and just some extra chaff and particulate. So you're going to end up with this stuff, and now what you could do with this is you could get, once again, a finer screen and shake it through again to just get your seeds out, or you could do something really cool, really smart, which is right behind me. This is an old-fashioned air column or a winnower. And what it is, it's very simple. It's just a little table. Looks like maybe a nightstand table from the olden days, and I don't know how old this thing is. But it basically has a nice motor with a fan. The fan blows up this little plastic tube. And in the tube here, there's a few sections. And this first section is just a clear tube. And in this first section, it has a little screen there. So the air could go up the screen. It's going to blow air through the screen. And you're going to put, actually, we're going to do it right now. We're going to take the seeds, the shaft, and all that's not separated, and we're going to pour it in. Very simple, very easy. And you can see all the seeds here sitting on top of the screen. Then we're going to put this next piece on. This next piece, what it is it's just a column. And you can shoot down the column. You'll see down in that column they have these basically baffles. So the air could go through the baffles, but as the stuff flows up, all the chaff and everything's gonna get stuck in the baffles and we'll be left with some clean seeds. So next we're gonna go ahead and put this on. And whenever using one of these guys, you wanna always hold the top on so it doesn't blow off, because this can be a significant amount of air. So we're gonna put my hand right there. And they have an on-off switch. We're gonna just click that on. And you can hear that, the motor running, the fan going, and we have this little control dial right here, this little control. So we're gonna gently ease this up, and we're gonna ease the throttle up, just like if you're driving an airplane, you wanna crank it up. And you're gonna see right here, the seeds are gonna kinda be getting blown by the air. The shaft, you can see that starting to float up. We're gonna do this a little bit slower, a little bit faster. You can see the seeds are starting to rotate on the bottom, and all the shafts getting blown up the tube. And now you can see really a lot of the shaft is being blown up this tube all the way up, and it's being collected up at the top in the baffles. We're going to turn this up a little bit higher. And you can see now all the shaft is getting blown up to the top and just circulating in this little area. And you can see in the middle area, you're going to see some of these seeds. Some of these seeds are floating. And the reason why some of these seeds are floating is some seeds are on the bottom, is that the seeds on the bottom are the heavy seeds. And these are the ones that are maybe hollow and maybe not viable. So it's probably good that if they float up a little bit. And as you can see now, we got it up pretty high. And down here we have mostly all seeds, and up here we have all the remnants and the chaff that we don't want. So we're gonna go ahead and turn the machine off. And we're gonna take this apart and see what we got. So in this top part here, you can see at the top of this tube is another screen, so only the air can move out. And this is all the chaff and all the stuff that got stuck in the baffles. And we're going to just go ahead and pour this out. And so this is all the bad seed and all the chaff. And in this tube, for the most part, we have all seeds. So now we can pour these seeds out. And aside from this one big piece that was fairly heavy that we could just manually pick out, we have all fresh seeds now that you could save. So definitely a really useful tool. That's another Christmas gift you guys could buy me. Or you could probably make one up, you know, with a leaf blower, something like that. But you need to be able to control the amount of airflow. And there's probably some plans online to look up for this. If you do a search for how to make your own, you'll probably make one of these at home. And if you do make one, hey, make a video on it to show me how you did it. And maybe one of these days when I have a big need, I'll be making my own too. Time for another Mother Earth News. Did you know that you can grow your own gas? If you grow your own corn, you can distill it more than 300 gallons of ethanol from 1 acre of corn. So, I don't know, do you use 300 gallons of gas a year? I always like hanging out to the end of these events because they give away free stuff. So right here, they're giving away some cool Mother Earth magazines. Mother Earth News, save money with DIY solar. And let's see, Capper's about sheep. Let's see. Gas Engine Magazine. So I think I'll just stick with the Mother Earth News. And the magazine I like the most here they're giving away is the Mother Earth News Building Hoop House to Grow More Food. So you can see a hoop house they built. And they have the very plans in here on how to grow that hoop house. So that's why I like Mother Earth News. They have a lot of DIY or do-it-yourself articles that'll tell you exactly how to build these things that you don't know how to. So I definitely have a subscription to Mother Earth, and I encourage you to also. Time for another Mother Earth News. Did you know? Did you know Garden at Home in 2010 Mother Earth News readers grew an estimated $1 billion worth of their own food? And hopefully growing your greens viewers grow at least $1 million worth of food at home. So we're here in the Mother Earth News bookstore, and they have all these different books, like stacks and stacks of tables. Each table has like a different theme: renewable energy, community and nature, do-it-yourself, natural health. But we're in the organic gardening section. This is my favorite section, and I don't have a lot of time because they just closed to go over a lot of the books. But I do want to point out my one favorite book here, and I encourage all my viewers to get it. This one's called Don't Throw It, Grow It. It's Kitchen Magic, and this one has 68 windowsill plants from kitchen scraps that you can grow as house plants to grow your own food at home. And it's a really inexpensive book, $10.95. And I mean, it'll tell you how to grow your own caraway as a house plant. I mean, they had carob, sapodilla, pineapple, papaya, so many different things: almonds, turnips, sweet potatoes, summer squash, radish, potatoes, peas, beans, all kinds of cool stuff. So go out and get this book. This Mother Earth News Fair has come to an end. Hope you've enjoyed this episode. Once again, my name is John Kohler with GrowingYourGreens.com, encouraging everybody to grow their own fruits and vegetables at home. We'll see you next time.